I mean, if you have your Bibles this morning, turn to Mark chapter 9, verse 14. Mark chapter 9, verse 14. We're going to be reading from there today. Can I just mention, and forgive me for potentially sticking my neck out here, but how many know your pastor said that he used to get jealous of me because I'm a church kid. And what that means is that church kids have all these talents and things just because they're raised in church and exposed to all this stuff. But I thought your pastor done quite a good job at song leading today. Yeah. Done very well, amen? He never told me he could sing. I would say that there are many other potential song leaders out there that maybe that would God could stir your heart to help out your church one day. Amen. We've got one at the back. Who knows? Amen. Mark chapter 9, verse 14, if you have your Bibles this morning. There's a pastor friend of mine. I was speaking to him just a few weeks ago. And he was telling me a story of many years ago when he was at work. He was working on a trailer with someone, and there were, you know, some manual work and some driving and things. And there was a man who he was working with, he was driving with, and the man was not a Christian in the slightest, didn't have any Christian perspective or foundation or belief in Jesus. But the man was very, very sick. And my friend, he is a man of faith. And he said, well, you know what? Why don't I pray for you? And the man just responded, ah, you know, I don't believe in all that rubbish. I don't want you to pray. And my friend said, how do you know unless you try? Why don't you just try and you can, I'll pray for you. So they agreed to pray. And after the prayer, the man felt a complete freedom from his pain and testified of being completely healed. His breathing was easier. His headache had gone immediately afterwards. He couldn't believe it that he felt a touch of God, the God in whom he didn't believe it. But the question I want to pose to you this morning as we minister is the problem with that is this man didn't believe. He didn't believe, meaning he didn't have faith. So how did he get healed? We know that faith is the currency of heaven. And I want to answer this morning a complicated question. What do believers do, or what do Christians do with doubt in their faith? I want to minister today, but what if I doubt? From Mark chapter 9, verse 14. I hope to answer this question to encourage and strengthen your faith as men and women of God. Mark chapter 9, verse 14. The scripture said, but when he came to the disciples, he saw a great multitude around them. This is Jesus coming to the disciples and the scribes disputing with them. Immediately when he saw they saw him, all the people were greatly amazed and running to him, greeted him. And he asked the scribes, what are you discussing with them? Then one of the crowd answered and said, teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him down and he foams at the mouth. He gnashes with his teeth and he becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast it out, but they could not. And he answered and said to them, oh, faithless generation, how long will I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring him to me. Then they brought him to him. And when he saw him, immediately the spirit convulsed him and fell on the ground, and he wallowed, foaming at the mouth. So he asked his father, how long has this been happening to him? And he said, since childhood. And often he has thrown him both into the fire and the water to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Verse 23 to 27, Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Immediately the father of the child said with tears, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. When Jesus saw that the people came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit and said, deaf and dumb spirit, I command you, come out of him and enter him no more. Then the spirit cried out and convulsed him greatly and came out of him, and he became as one dead. And many said, he is dead, but Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he arose. Let's consider today, what if I doubt? Let me look first of all, church, at do not doubt, question mark. The Bible tells us, as I mentioned already, that faith is the currency of heaven. If you and I today, as people of God, if we want to get anything done, then we need to be a people who have faith. And there are many scriptures throughout the Bible that will tell you in black and white, do not doubt. Jesus taught us on prayer in Matthew 21, 21. I say to you, if you have faith and do not doubt. Hebrews chapter 3 actually talks about this, and it says, beware, brethren, lest there be any of you with an evil heart of unbelief in departing from the living God. I mean, and then it continues in James 1, 6 and 7. James pulls out the double barrel shotgun, if you like, and he says, let him ask in faith with no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. Let that man suppose that he will not receive anything from the Lord. He is double-minded and unstable in all his ways. So how many know this morning, you read that dialogue, you read that idea of what the scripture is talking about, and at face value, you assume I must never, ever doubt. If people do doubt, number one, what happens is they try really, really, really hard to not doubt and have no doubt possibly in their mind. I know it's raining outside, and I know we have outreach, and we're praying for the rain to stop, but I mustn't think that it won't stop raining. I mustn't stop. Have you ever been there? Said, Lord, it's going to stop raining. Oh, Lord, help it stop raining. You say, I can't do that because I mustn't doubt. Number two, what happens is if you do doubt, you can feel like a very bad Christian. I'm not like those people of faith. Man, I'm not the same caliber as them, men and women. Maybe I'm not worthy. And this emphasis on perfect faith has been very much the foundation of the hyper-faith movement that we see in the church world today. There's a man called Andrew Womack, and his idea of a doctrine of faith, which is completely unbiblical, basically says, if you're not healed, then it's your fault. Because you didn't have faith. There's nothing wrong with God. There's nothing wrong with his perspective. It's your fault. And so the blame of parents who don't have who have sick children, or you have someone that's cancer and they don't get healed, and now not only do I have this problem, it's now my fault because I didn't have pure faith, and because I doubted once or twice, that's why they weren't healed. You see, in our text today, this man's faith has large traces of doubt. It was not pure faith, if you put it that way. And I don't think he's the only one. Thomas, after the crucifixion, he has the report of the resurrection. What does he say? Unless I see the holes in his hands, I will not believe. John chapter 14, Thomas again. He said, Lord, how do we know where you're going? I'm not so confident about what you're saying right now. Thomas saw all of the miracles. He would have known the power of prayer, yet he still had visible and obvious doubts. And I believe today that the average Christian lives with and amongst doubts on a regular basis. You know, think about doubt. It is actually a God-given human instinct to question things. It is a good thing to observe. Think about praying. Have you ever prayed and you finished your prayer and you think, is God even hearing me? I'm not sure if I'm speaking to the wall, or I don't know where this is going, but I don't feel any supernatural movement right now. Maybe you've got a deadline to meet, and you, is God going to come through here? Now think about pioneers. When you get launched out into the ministry, there are couples here, you have destiny, and one day you get launched out into the ministry. There is no way, I've done it myself, you go out in faith, you're believing God, we're going to see revival, we're going to see God move, you're praying, you're fasting, you're ready to see everything happen, but there's no way that in the back of the pioneer's head, there's not ever a question where he says, is this really going to work? Am I wasting my time here? Why did I move my family to a city to do this thing? There are doubts there. You see, doubt can actually be a protection against being defrauded. Those who don't question things become incredibly gullible. When some people, they could tell you, the sky is green, the grass is blue, and you say, wow, no way, I never saw it like that before. Hi, my name is Tom Good to Be True. I'm going to offer you £1 million if you just give me your bank details. Well, thank God I've been praying for blessing. 1 John 4 verse 1, beloved, do not believe every spirit, but test the spirits whether they are of God. Do not believe is the opposite of having faith. To trust, it's telling you, the scripture is telling you, don't trust every spirit. Don't believe everything that seems spiritual. You might have heard of this crazy preacher in Jamaica a couple of months ago or so, and I only heard reports secondhand, but he was claiming to be Jesus ends up killing someone or sacrificing someone. And why would you do that? Why would people in his congregation follow him? Because I mustn't have doubt. And he would no doubt have been producing, you must have faith, you must believe, don't doubt, it's from the devil. Well, actually, they could have saved their skin if they just doubted and didn't believe that spirit. See, in this scripture, this man had both faith and unbelief. He says in verse 22, if you can. There are times and seasons in a Christian's relationship with God where you will wrestle with doubt and with faith. Jesus had just come down from the Mount of Transfiguration. I mean, sometimes we can seem like we're on the high. We're on the third heaven. We feel incredibly spiritual. We've got lightning coming out in our fingertips. But suddenly you're brought back to the reality of life. You're brought back to the mess of this child convulsing from the mountaintop to the mess. That's what faith can be like sometimes. There are a couple of reasons why we have doubts. Number one, because the present circumstance or physical reality often contradicts what our faith believes. This man wanted to believe, but his son was still being thrown into the fire, and it was almost like what he saw was an insult to what he was trying to confess. The children of Israel, in Exodus chapter 14, God said, go forward, but there's a sea in the way. It's not that I don't have faith, God, but I'm just telling you it's kind of impossible right now. That's really difficult to say yes when I can't walk on water. There's a lady I heard about in one of our churches. Her grandmother was on her deathbed, and they were believing for weeks. But when it got to that point, this young Christian girl said, I don't believe God can heal her. Because I believed up to this point, but now the circumstance is so real, it created doubt. Second reason why we doubt is because of an emotional connection. In our scripture, it was this man's son who was sick. I mean, it's easy to believe for someone else. It's easy to believe, to stretch out your hands and pray for them at the front. Oh, you'll be fine. Just trust God. Proverbs 3, blah, 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 all these things. But it's very different. It's very different when we feel it. It's very different when it's close to home, when there's serious consequences. I can have faith, but if this doesn't work out, there are some serious consequences right now. This is going to affect. It's no joke when it's your family. It's not a playground. It's not fun when it's your health or your money or your future. The third reason is because of past experiences. Verse 17 and 18 tells us, "Teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit. I spoke to your disciples, but they could not cast him out." This boy had already been on the prayer line at the front of church. He had already tried to do the spiritual thing, already tried to trust God, but it didn't work. I was thinking about Pastor Mitchell, the early days of our fellowship. He tried to pray for the sick, and guess what? No one got healed. It didn't work. I think it was for 7 years. He said, "I'm not praying for the sick." Because past experiences can create doubt in your faith. There's a preacher who said, "Some of you pray like a Concorde jet, smooth, sleek, high and mighty. Your words reverberate in the clouds and send sonic booms throughout the heavens. If you pray like a Concorde, I salute you. If you don't, I understand. Maybe you're like me, more like a crop duster than a Concorde. You're not flashy. You fly low. You seem to cover the same ground quite a lot. And some mornings it's really tough to get the engine cranked up. More often we come to God like a crippled lamb to a shepherd than a proud lion roaring in the jungle." Let me talk secondly then, church, about the dangers of doubt. So the question we have here is that if we all doubt, why does the Bible warn us so strongly? You need to understand, and we need to go through some study slightly. Matthew 21:21, if you have faith and do not doubt. So it would assume you can't doubt. But when you look a little bit closer, the Amplified Bible says, if you have faith, personal trust and confidence in me, and do not doubt or allow yourself to be drawn into two directions. See, there's two different words for the word doubt or unbelief in Scripture, and sometimes the English seems to me like it gets them cross-wired. The word doubt is back and forth. It can either be positively referring to close reasoning or discriminating someone, or negatively overjudging it or going too far. Only the context of the verse indicates what sense it is meant. See, if doubt is not dealt with, and I think this is where Scripture warns us, if your doubts are not balanced with faith, very quickly morphs into unbelief. The Greek word for unbelief is not a passive unbelief. I need you to remember this. It is a refusal to believe. It is an unwillingness to be persuaded. The word doubt in James 1:6, "Let no man doubt," is actually just to withdraw from, to separate thoroughly, or to hesitate. What does this mean for us? Doubt acknowledges the external. Unbelief makes the external the final word. Those who have faith, some people sit at the back of church, you don't really pray much, and you say, "I'm just a realist." You guys just don't see it, right? That's why I don't do the things you do, because you're just ignorant of these things. No, that's not true. People of faith are not ignorant. I don't do the will of God because I haven't thought of something else I could do. It's not because I can't see the circumstances or the complications, but actually people of faith merely override their doubt with faith. And if faith is pushed out by doubt, what that then becomes is unbelief. And there is a grave danger for the Christian here and now when working doubt morphs into unbelief. Consider Peter walking on the water. Think about this. It's an incredible scripture. The disciples were on the boat at night. There was a storm, and suddenly they see this figure. They think it's a ghost, and who would believe, but it's Jesus walking on the water. Peter stands on the edge of the boat, and he says, "Lord, if it's you, bid me to come on the water with you." He looks at Jesus, and he says, "Man, I want to do what you're doing." But his faith turned to doubt, and his doubt turned to unbelief. And look what happened. Matthew 14:31. Immediately Jesus stretched out his hands and caught him and said, "You of little faith, Why did you doubt? And when they got into the boat, the winds ceased. You see, church, when his eyes were on Jesus, it allowed him to walk on the water. But what changed, you would ask? The wind was still the same. The trouble and the water was still the same. The darkness of the night was still the same. Jesus was still the same. He had allowed his focus to change. And he says, man, you know what? These waves are looking way bigger than when I got out of the boat. But they were the same waves. But because he focused on them, he no longer was working with faith, and he sunk. I was told about some driving instructors, and if you've ever, you might have heard this from your driving instructor as well. And I remember talking to them and saying, what causes most crashes? And what he said was hesitation. See, all drivers, unless you're really, really bad, see hazards. We have a hazard perception test. They've now made it a lot harder. When I was passed, there's like 30 questions. Now there's like 50 something, I think. I probably wouldn't have passed. But what happens with a driver is that you see the hazard. How many know you keep driving anyway? Right? What they say is that the reason why many people crash is because they allow the hazard to cause them to stop what they're doing and stop the flow of what's going on. If you just kind of, you ever heard that? You flow with the traffic. Kind of like it seems really crazy, but it's like a safe way to drive. You're taking things as you go, but you're not letting it stop you from moving forward. Doubt is part of the reality of driving, but it's when your driving is dictated by your doubts, that's when you're going to crash. You focus on it, and how many know when you focus on it, you start driving towards it. You're trying to avoid the thing, but you're focused, you're actually driving towards the problem. Unbelief refuses to give God any room to move. Think about Jesus' hometown in Matthew 13:58. He did not do many mighty works there because of their unbelief. It is possible for you to look at the waves of your past. It is possible for you today to look at your failures. It's possible to be looking at other people, to be looking at the future battles and be unwilling to be persuaded, or actually you refuse to believe. It's almost like there's a big spiritual sign on your faith that says, you know what, God, my arms are crossed, I'm not interested. I don't believe. I remember speaking to a man, talking to me about his marriage. I said to him, do you believe? I don't believe my marriage can get better. See, that's not doubt. That's not seeing problems and saying, man, you've got to help me with that. What that is arms crossed. This isn't going to change. Nothing's going to move here. I don't have destiny anymore. The supernatural can't change this. One of the reasons why an unbeliever doesn't believe is because he's not actually interested in gaining more faith. That's why, hey, you believe? No, I'm not sure. You talk to people on outreach, they're not sure about it. But they're actually not interested. They don't really care to seek God or not, and so they don't. But I realize that actually when we get to this place, we can have the very same mindset and spirit as an unbeliever. I'm not interested in gaining more faith here because I don't want to believe it. We might not say it, but unbelief can reside in the heart of the Christian. And what we're saying is, God, this door is closed for business. Our text shows us we cannot afford to stay in the place of doubt forever. So let me talk finally then, church, about faith that moves mountains. See, in our text today, we find a very powerful truth about the goodness of God. God is willing to work with your doubts. Jesus actually sets a standard for him to rise to, and that standard is the standard called faith. Hebrews 11, verse 1, now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. What faith then is that it is believing in the promise or possibility of God moving in spite of what you see or you've experienced so far. Let me explain it this way. How many people have ever bought something from eBay? A few people? Okay. You buy something on the internet or on eBay, you know what? You get that little thing and the confirmation page is on the way, right? And it comes on and you've got the little red, the payment receipt and everything. You know what? You know that it's on the way, don't you? But you don't actually know. You don't know because you haven't seen it yet. It's not here, it's not real, it's not physical, it's not at your door, but you have something that says there is evidence of the thing that I don't see. Verse 23, if you can believe, all things are possible. What Jesus is saying is if you'd believe for your future. He is saying if you'd believe for your marriage. I don't believe it can change. You've got to believe it can change. You must believe it can change. You've got to believe for your children. If you can believe for your destiny or for your health. And I think that Jesus knows that he's asking something difficult. He's asking us, when he gives us a challenge of faith, he's actually asking us to rise to this challenge. He's asking us, I want you to look beyond what you understand and what you experience right now. This man's response with tears, I believe, but help my unbelief. If you're here today and you don't have unwavering faith like most of us, you can understand and you can take courage in this man's statement. Because this man boldly confessed his unbelief and he asked for help. One commentator said, my faith is far from perfect. If it's not enough, please, Lord, help it to be enough. God works with the imperfect faith that you might bring to him this morning. When Thomas said, I will not believe unless I see, did Jesus rebuke him? He didn't. What he'd done is he held out his hand. He lifted up his side and he said, Thomas, I want you to believe. John 20, verse 27, reach your finger in here. Do not be unbelieving, but believing. When Gideon doubted his calling in God, and God, I'm sorry, don't one more time, please, can you confirm it with me again? You know what God done? He didn't rebuke Gideon. What the Bible says is that he gave him the fleece and he done it twice for him. I'm telling you today, Christian, there is more faith inside of you than you might realize. Romans 12, verse 3, think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. You know, in Matthew's recollection of this story of this young boy, when the disciples ask Jesus, Jesus goes on and he talks about a parable. And he says, because of their unbelief, Matthew 17, 20, I say to you, if anyone has the faith the size of a mustard seed, you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. If I was to show you a mustard seed right now, you would barely be able to see it in my hand. It's just a dot. It's a small, small seed. And what Jesus is saying, it's almost a rebuke. He said to them, listen, guys, if your faith was so small that it was the size of a mustard seed, even with that faith, you could move mountains. Even with that faith, God can move for you. Even with that faith, God can move. But it's way bigger than that. He was going to the extreme. If it's only that big, trust me, he said, I can still use it to bring something into fruition. Can I say to you today that there is more inside of you than a mustard seed faith? Perhaps this morning, where with, I don't know, COVID or the circumstances of life or wherever you're at right now, you just seem to have enough faith to come to the altar. You just have enough faith to seek God and ask him. You just have enough faith to kind of step onto outreach on Saturday. You barely even believing that someone could get saved or God could use your life, but you have enough faith to say, Lord, I don't know how this is all going to work out, but God, I'm not going to let my doubts dictate what I do for you. Lord, I'm having faith anyway, simply enough to move. How many people, you might remember Indiana Jones if you're my generation or older? Indiana Jones, I don't remember the story so much, but I do remember one clip at the end of one of the movies, and it was the Walk of Faith Bridge. And what this bridge was is that Indiana Jones had to get across this big canyon, and he would have died if he fell. And the way that he went across is that every time he would step, it was just an open canyon, but every time he would step, a piece of the bridge would form under his feet. So he would step, there's no bridge, he's there, and as he would step down, suddenly the bridge would form. The next step, the bridge would form. They don't make it easy, do they? But how many know that's exactly what it's like for you and I? You just need enough faith to step. You just need enough faith to pray, to get up, to go and obey, to speak. In Acts chapter 10, I'm drawing this to a close, Peter spoke. God spoke to Peter about Cornelius' servants. At first, Peter said, "Not so, Lord. I'm not believing that. Not so ever." He was the kind of unbelief kind of picture. No, it's not going to happen with me. But eventually, God worked on him. And he said, "Arise, therefore, go down with them." There was a knock on the door. "Doubt nothing, for I have sent them." I think Peter, when he opened the door, still had doubts. He still had cultural issues. He still had things he wasn't sure about God about. He didn't necessarily like these people. But he had enough faith to trust God, to open the door. And that faith triggered the revival of the Gentiles. I close with this. How does God help us to overcome our doubt with our faith? Number one, with promises. Verse 23, if you can believe, all things are possible. Sometimes all you have to go on this morning is the promises of God. And you know what? That's what they're designed to do. When you don't have anything else, you can tie a knot at the end of the rope and you can hold on for dear life and say, "No, no, no, this is where I'm staying." You can remember them, you can pray through them, you can focus on them, and they will help you combat the doubt of your life. Number two, through people. In our text, Jesus came down from the mountain with James and John and Peter. Here were these faith-filled brothers. God, you know, what's important is you get around spiritual people. Sometimes, you know what? Sometimes the people you hang around with are not going to help your faith. Right? It might be good to get around some spiritual brothers, and they're going to help you with faith. 2 Corinthians 7:5, outside were conflicts, inside were fears. Nevertheless, God who comforts the downhearted comforted us by the coming of Titus. I had many doubts, but Titus helped our faith. Number three is purpose. I'm here today to let you know that you still have a purpose in God. You are still needed, Christian. You are not wasted. There are times when I've doubted the presence of God because of what's going on around me, but I realize, you know what? No, God called me here. God put me here, and the purpose of God is enough to give your faith context to believe in. And finally, amen, there is power through prayer and the Holy Spirit. Verse 29, this kind does not come out except for prayer and for fasting. I close with this. There was an organist who was getting ready to play as their service began one day. And when he put his hands to the keys, there was no sound on the piano or on the organ. Everyone knew that something was wrong. Everyone started to wonder what was going on and things, what's happening and should we? And quickly, the preacher, he got up and he kind of, "Everyone, we're going to start today in prayer." And he led in prayer. The janitor who was at the back, he remembered that as he was cleaning up, something looked different with the organ. And so he went to the organ when everyone was playing and he plugged it in. Something wasn't plugged in. He wrote a note to the preacher and he put it up on the pulpit. And what it read was, "After the prayer, the power will be on." I want to tell you today, if you would start with some prayer, "God, I have enough faith to trust you, to seek you. God's going to work with the doubts that are stopping you from moving for him. Amen. Can we have every head bowed, every eye closed today? We want to pray.